There's a ghost that has always haunted the climate change debate. It's the ghost of a Serbian mathematician who, just before the outbreak of World War I, during the Belle Époque, had the audacious idea of trying to trace the causes of the ice ages our planet has gone through over the last hundreds of thousands of years. The mathematician's name was Milutin Milankovitch, and his theory is still at the center of heated debates. Some see it as a proof that climate changes, without the invasive presence of our species, occur purely due to natural causes, particularly astronomical ones. Others believe that the current global warming is mainly the work of humans. Who's right? What if they're both right? The link between Milankovitch cycles and Earth's climate has been demonstrated through the analysis of climatic data and geological evidence. However, if ice ages were solely caused by astronomical circumstances, it would be relatively easy to establish that the cold-warm cycles should repeat very slowly, approximately every 40,000 years, and not show such a damn fast progression as we've seen in less than a century. In this video, we'll try to give a definitive answer to both Milankovitch's supporters and opponents, maybe just to conclude that, as often happens, the truth lies somewhere in between. Or maybe not. Hey, curious mind, ever heard about the assassin's water bottle? What's that? How does it work? Okay, before we dive back into this insane curiosity episode, we've got something really insane for you, something you and your friends will love. The assassin's water bottle. This gadget was inspired by an ancient Chinese Ming Dynasty teapot used to pour two different liquids from the same teapot, but separately. Legend says it was used to discreetly serve deadly poison or harmless tea. It's as simple as covering one air hole with your thumb. Boom! Instantly switch between liquids without anyone noticing. Water on one side, poison on the other. The assassin's water bottle is one of those must-have gadgets. Fool your friends, prank your coworkers, or just keep yourself double hydrated. But that's not all. The bottle's sleek design is more than just functional. It's a conversation starter packed with hidden curiosities about foggy and mysterious nights. Trust me, jaws will drop. Pre-orders won't last long. Get your assassin's bottle before it's sold out. Hit the link below and claim yours now before they're gone for good. We all know it. Our lives literally revolve around cycles. A series of events that repeat regularly in the same order. There are hundreds of different types of cycles in our world and the universe. Some are natural, like the changing seasons, annual animal migrations, or the circadian rhythms that govern our sleep patterns. Others are man-made, like the planting and harvesting of crops, musical rhythms, or economic cycles. Cycles also play a key role in Earth's short-term weather and long-term climate. A century ago, Serbian scientist Milutin Milankovitch hypothesized that the long-term collective effects of changes in Earth's position relative to the Sun were a major driver of Earth's long-term climate and were responsible for triggering the start and end of ice ages. He was also convinced that the entire cycle of major ice ages over the last million years could be explained by considering that the Sun, Earth, and other planets aren't perfect billiard balls moving in constant orbits and rotating in the same way. Everything changes in the universe. Everything is in a constant state of flux. According to Milankovitch, three astronomical variables were responsible for these changes: the eccentricity of Earth's orbit, the tilt of its rotational axis, and the so-called precession of the equinoxes. Let's take the first one, orbital eccentricity, which is the ratio of the distance from the Sun-occupied focus to the center of the ellipse and the average distance of Earth. Eccentricity is basically a measure of how much an ellipse deviates from a perfect circle. In the context of Earth's orbit, it refers to the degree of elongation of the elliptical path. When eccentricity is low, the orbit is close to a circle, while when it's high, the orbit becomes more elongated. Currently, Earth's orbit is almost circular, with an eccentricity of about 0.0167. But that almost means the difference between aphelion, the farthest point from the Sun, and perihelion, the closest point, is about 5 million kilometers. Not exactly trivial, right? But as we said, everything changes. And indeed, due to gravitational attractions with other planets over a cycle of about 92,000 years, Earth's orbital eccentricity varies from a minimum of 0.0034 to a maximum of 0.058, with a difference between aphelion and perihelion that can reach up to 17 million kilometers. This difference causes a 6.8% increase in solar radiation reaching Earth. Currently, perihelion occurs around January 3rd, while aphelion is around July 4th. When the orbit has maximum eccentricity, the amount of solar radiation at perihelion is about 23% greater than at aphelion. Orbital eccentricity is also why our seasons currently have slightly different lengths, with summer in the northern hemisphere being 4.5 days longer than winter and spring about 3 days longer than autumn. For a perfectly circular orbit, these differences would disappear, while they increase if the orbit becomes elliptical. For the southern hemisphere, the effect is the opposite, with winter longer than summer and autumn longer than spring. All these factors influence the amount of light received by Earth's surface, both in the short term and, more significantly, over the 92,000-year cycle. The second variable Milankovitch mentioned is the tilt of the Earth's rotational axis on the plane of the ecliptic, which oscillates from 22.5 degrees to 24.5 degrees over about 41,000 years. Currently, Earth's axis is tilted at 23.4 degrees, roughly halfway between its extremes, and this angle is decreasing very slowly. The last time it reached its maximum tilt was about 10,000 years ago, and it will reach its minimum tilt in about 10,000 years. As the obliquity decreases, it gradually makes our seasons milder, resulting in warmer winters and cooler summers, which over time allows snow and ice at high latitudes to accumulate into large ice sheets. As the ice cover increases, it reflects more of the sun's energy back into space, promoting further cooling. As obliquity increases, the amplitude of the seasonal cycle of insolation increases, with more radiative flux in the summers of both hemispheres and a corresponding decrease in winters. Consequently, summers become hotter and winters colder. The third important variation is the orientation of Earth's rotational axis. While Earth rotates on its axis, it also wobbles slightly, like a spinning top. This wobble is due to tidal forces caused by the gravitational influences of the Sun and the Moon. The trend in the direction of this wobble relative to the fixed positions of the stars is known as axial precession. The axial precession cycle lasts about 25,770 years. Hey guys, just a moment before we continue. Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell, you'll help us to make products of even higher quality. But how do we know it's not Milankovitch cycles to blame? First, Milankovitch cycles operate on long timescales, ranging from tens of thousands to hundreds of thousands of years. In contrast, the current warming of Earth has occurred on timescales ranging from decades to centuries. Over the past 150 years, Milankovitch cycles haven't significantly altered the amount of solar energy absorbed by Earth. In fact, NASA's satellite observations show that over the last 40 years, solar radiation has actually decreased slightly. Second, Milankovitch cycles are just one factor that can contribute to climate change, both past and present. Even for ice age cycles, changes in the extent of ice sheets and atmospheric carbon dioxide have played a crucial role in determining the degree of temperature fluctuations over the past millions of years. There's a general consensus that whether an ice age occurs also depends on the composition of the atmosphere, which plays a key role in trapping or eliminating carbon dioxide, nitrogen oxides, and other elements emitted by volcanic eruptions, all gases that increase or decrease the greenhouse effect. The extent of ice sheets, for example, influences the amount of solar energy reflected into space and, consequently, Earth's temperature. Then there's carbon dioxide. During past glacial cycles, the concentration of carbon dioxide in our atmosphere fluctuated from about 180 parts per million to 280 parts per million as part of the climate changes driven by Milankovitch cycles. These fluctuations provided important feedback to the overall climate change occurring during those cycles. Today, however, it's the direct release of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere from burning fossil fuels that's responsible for changing Earth's atmospheric composition over the last century, rather than climate feedbacks from the ocean or land caused by Milankovitch cycles. Since the beginning of the industrial era, the concentration of carbon dioxide in Earth's atmosphere has increased by 50%, from about 280 parts per million to 421 parts per million in 2023. Scientists know with a high degree of certainty that this carbon dioxide is primarily due to human activities, because the carbon produced by burning fossil fuels leaves a distinct fingerprint that instruments can measure. Since 1850, Earth's average global temperature has increased by over 1 degree Celsius, 1.8 degrees Fahrenheit. Moreover, recent scientific assessments show that Earth is expected to warm by another half degree Celsius, almost 1 degree Fahrenheit, by 2030. This relatively rapid warming of our climate due to human activities is occurring in addition to the very slow climate changes caused by Milankovitch cycles. Climate models indicate that any forcing of Earth's climate due to Milankovitch cycles is overwhelmed when human activities cause atmospheric carbon dioxide concentrations to exceed about 350 parts per million. One of its tangible and measurable effects is to make the succession of seasons occur a bit earlier each year, thus causing the equinoxes and solstices to precede or shift forward in time, which over time changes the dates when Earth reaches perihelion and aphelion. This makes seasonal contrasts more extreme in one hemisphere and less extreme in the other. Currently, perihelion occurs during winter in the northern hemisphere and summer in the southern hemisphere. This makes southern hemisphere summers hotter and moderates seasonal variations in the northern hemisphere. But in about 13,000 years, axial precession will reverse these conditions, with the northern hemisphere experiencing more extreme solar radiation and the southern hemisphere having more moderate seasonal variations. Are we still on track? Great! According to Milankovitch, the combined effects of these cycles influence the amount of solar energy reaching Earth in different seasons and at different latitudes, leading to significant changes in Earth's climate. Milankovitch reached this conclusion by creating a comprehensive mathematical model that allowed him to calculate differences in solar radiation at various latitudes on Earth, along with corresponding surface temperatures. The model is like a climate time machine. It can be run forward and backward to examine past and future climate conditions. Using it, the Serbian mathematician calculated that ice ages occur on Earth approximately every 41,000 years. Milankovitch's work was supported by other researchers of his time, but it was only after his death in 1958 that the global scientific community began to take his theory seriously. In 1976, a study published in the journal Science by Hayes and others, using data extracted from deep-sea sediment cores, supported the idea that Milankovitch cycles indeed correspond to significant climatic changes over the past 450,000 years, marked by the periodic variations in Earth's orbit. Although the Milankovitch cycle theory has gained broad acceptance in explaining long-term climate variations, there are criticisms and challenges to consider. Timing issues. Some critics argue that the timing of ice ages does not exactly match the timings predicted based on Milankovitch cycles. There are discrepancies in the phase relationships between different orbital parameters and the observed climatic variations. Amplification mechanisms. Milankovitch cycles alone might not be sufficient to explain the magnitude of climatic changes observed in ice core records. Amplification mechanisms such as feedback processes involving ice albedo effects and greenhouse gas concentrations are necessary to account for the observed variability. Nonlinear dynamics. The climate system is highly complex and exhibits nonlinear dynamics. Small changes in initial conditions or external forcings can lead to disproportionately large and unpredictable responses. In this regard, it's crucial to understand that the alternation of glacial and interglacial periods is driven by seemingly minor temperature variations. For instance, the average temperature during a glacial period is only 4 to 6 degrees Celsius lower than the average temperature of an interglacial period. Despite these doubts, whether founded or not, in recent decades, so-called global warming skeptics have occasionally pointed to Milankovitch cycles as evidence that the current undeniable warming phase is part of an exclusively natural cycle. However, the overwhelming consensus in the scientific community is that the unprecedented rate of temperature increase observed in recent decades is solely due to human activity and the exponential growth of carbon dioxide emissions into the atmosphere. Milankovitch cycles, according to proponents of anthropogenic warming, cannot explain all the climatic changes that have occurred over the past 2.5 million years or so. More importantly, they cannot explain the current period of rapid warming that Earth has experienced since the pre-industrial period, between 1850 and 1900, and especially since the mid-20th century. Scientists are convinced that the recent warming of Earth is primarily due to human activities, particularly the direct release of carbon dioxide into Earth's atmosphere from the burning of fossil fuels. Scientists don't know of any natural changes in the balance between the amount of solar radiation absorbed by Earth and the amount of energy radiated into space that could explain such a rapid period of global warming. The amount of incoming solar radiation has only increased slightly over the past century, and therefore isn't a determining factor in Earth's current climate warming. Since 1750, the warming caused by greenhouse gases from human fossil fuel combustion is over 50 times greater than the slight extra warming from the sun itself over the same period. If the current warming of Earth were due to the sun, scientists say we would expect temperatures in both the lower atmosphere, troposphere, and the next layer of the atmosphere, the stratosphere, to warm. Instead, balloon and satellite observations show that Earth's surface and lower atmosphere have warmed, but the stratosphere has cooled. Finally, Earth is currently in an interglacial period, a warmer period between ice ages. Without human influences on the climate, scientists say that the Earth's current orbital positions within Milankovitch cycles predict that our planet should be cooling, not warming, continuing a long-term cooling trend that began 6,000 years ago. To wrap up, Milankovitch was certainly right in assigning the grand cosmic cycles the role of shaping the seemingly chaotic changes in Earth's climate, but he didn't account for the physics of Earth's atmosphere or the frightening growth of the human population and its capacity to impact the environment. However, his contributions to understanding the relationship between astronomical factors and climate variability have left a lasting legacy, significantly influencing the fields of climatology, paleoclimatology, and the study of Earth's past climates. In other words, the Serbian scientist's theory admirably fits the climatic evolution of a primordial planet like Earth before the appearance of humans. What happened afterwards has proven to be beyond any possible prediction.